So let's continue. We were considering the spanning set of these three vectors u1, u2, u3. We had discovered earlier they span a plane in R3. Now we used a different method. We used the so-called row space, and we discovered that the spanning set, the same as spanned by these three vectors, can be spanned by two vectors, R1 and R2, by using row space of a matrix that we created. And now I want to see what is this plane they spanned. I can write, for instance, parametric equations of this plane. These are plane in R3, so it consists of position vectors, and therefore it will pass through the origin. And I know how to write parametric equations of a plane. I will say position vector R will be one parameter times R1 plus another parameter S by vector R2. Or we can say x, y, z will be t multiplied, in our case, 1, negative 1, 0, plus s multiplied by 0, 1, 1. These are direction vectors of the plane, yes? These are the vectors that span our plane, yes? Direction vectors of the plane. Direction vectors of the plane. So, can I write a normal equation of this plane? Yes, I know that if I want to write normal equations of this plane, I have two direction vectors, R1 and R2. They are linear independent, so they are certainly non-collinear. If I take their cross product, I will get vector A, or by some other method, or I can require n orthogonal to R1 and n orthogonal to R2, right? I can get vector n. Let's try. What will be our vector n? Vector n will be R1 cross R2. So it will be I, j, k, 1, negative 1, 0 is R1, and 0, 1, 1 is R2. So what's going to be? I multiplied by negative 1, so negative I. J will be with minus, and it will be multiplied by 1 minus 0, so minus J. And K will be multiplied by 1 minus 0, plus K. So normal vector of this plane is negative 1, negative 1, 1. Can we write equation of this plane? Of course we can. Negative 1 x minus, and as a point x0, y0, z0, this will be fixed point, the origin. Because this plane is a plane in R3, so it does contain the origin. All the vectors in our in this space are position vectors, so our plane is also passing through the origin. So minus 1 x minus 0 plus negative 1 y minus 0 plus 1 z minus 0 equals to 0. Or we have negative x minus y plus z is equal to 0. If you remember, this is exactly the plane we received by a different method, by trying to find out what our vectors span when considering the very first example. So we have arrived to the same plane by a different method. Is there an advantage in this method? Yes, there is an advantage, because in case of three vectors in R3, it's pretty easy to say, to select two of them that may form a basis. Yes, I can just say this vector is not proportional to any of these. So this vector and this one is a basis. This vector and this one is a basis. Also this one and this one is a basis. And we found a different basis. We found this basis by using row operations. But if you have a multidimensional space and many vectors in it, it will be much, much harder to determine a basis in this subspace. That's why this second method, method with row operations, with row space of a matrix, is a universal method that always works in any dimensional space, no matter how many vectors are in your spanning set. And let's consider an example of such an application. We will have a few vectors in some space of many dimensions. Again, many because we are still humans, not computers. Many dimensions will be, I don't know, 5-dimensional space at most, 4-dimensional space. Something reasonable, right? But still we don't have an illustration for our methods. So, example number 3 for today. Find a basis in the spanning set of vectors v1, v2, v3, v4, which will be, I will take some vectors, one vector will be 1, 3, 2, negative 1, negative 2. It's a 5-dimensional space, R5. The next vector will be 1, 3, 3, 1, 2. 1, 3, 3, 1, 2. The next vector will be negative 2, negative 6, negative 3, 4, 0. And the last vector, we take a set of 4 vectors, negative 1, negative 3, 0, 5, 2. Which is, I wrote equals to this, no, it's not equal to this. It's equals to the spanning set of this vector. Yes, if I have span here, I must have span here. So find a basis in the spanning set of these vectors. So I will act the same way I did, I have shown in the last examples. Let's compose a matrix A which or whose row space is the span of v1, v2, v3, v4. Then by means of row operations we will get what we need. So I will say matrix A is, now I will write this matrix, these vectors in rows, 1, 3, 2, negative 1, negative 2, 1, 3, 3, 1, 2, negative 2, negative 6, negative 3, 4, 0, and negative 1, negative 3, 0, 5, 2. And we will start Gaussian elimination. So our first golden Gaussian elimination, make it 0, 0, and 0, yes? All the entries beneath the first row, the first entry of the first leading variable. So, row 2 changes to row 2 minus row 1. Row 3 changes to row 3 plus 2 row 1. And row 4 changes to row 4 plus row 1. As a result, we will have the first row unchanged, 1, 3, 2, negative 1, negative 2. Then we will have 0, right? 0, 3 minus 3, 0, 3 minus 2, 1. 1 minus negative 1, 2. And 2 minus negative 2 will be 4. Then we will be negative 2 plus 2, 0. Negative 6 plus 6 will be 0. Negative 3 plus 4 will be 1. 4 minus 2 will be 2. And 0 minus 4 will be, and 0. Right? Doesn't matter. 0 minus 0 plus negative 4 will be negative 4. Negative 4. The next one will be 0 minus 3 plus 3 is 0. 0 plus 2 will be 2. Right? 5 minus 1 will be 4. And 2 minus 2 will be 0. Right? The next step, we have to create zeros beneath the second leading entry, which means here and here. So my next operation will be row 3 changes to row 3 minus row 2. I'm just checking people so I didn't make any mistakes. Row 2. And row 3 changes to row 3 minus row 2. I hope I did not make mistakes. Row 4 changes to row 4 plus, here now, row 4 changes to row 4 minus 2, row 2. This way we will get zeros where we need. Now it will be 1, 3, 2, negative 1, negative 2, 0, 0, 1. 0. Zero, one, two, four. Then it will be 0, 0, 0. And 0 again. And negative 4, negative 4, negative 8. And it will be 0, 0, 0. And 4 minus 4 again, 0. And here will be 0. Plus 8, right? So it will be 8. So we have again another, we have this leading entry, this leading entry, this leading entry. So we must make this one 0, which is not difficult. So I will say row 4 changes to row 4 plus row 3. Row 3, just to make things easier, I will replace with negative 1 8 of row 3. You don't have to have this leading entry to be equal to 1, but it is more convenient. And then I will have 1, 3, 2, negative 1, negative 2, 0, 0, 1, 2, 4, and 0, 0, 0, 0, 1. And 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. This is already a row echelon form of the matrix. You can see that each of these rows is a linear combination of our original 4 rows, right? What is good about these rows? They are linearly independent, right? If I consider for instance, I will write them again as columns. The linear combination equal to 0 if I write x1 multiplied by 1, 3, 2, negative 1, negative 2, plus x2 multiplied by 0, 0, 1, 2, 4, plus x3 multiplied by 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, and I require it to be equal to 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, it's pretty clear that no matter what I do in the left hand side, when I add them, the very first entry inevitably will be x1 multiplied by 1. So it will be x1 and some other stuff beneath it. I don't even care now what it will be. When I add all these three columns multiplied by x is equals to 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. So what do you think for x1? No matter what comes from these other columns, x1 multiplied by 1 is here. So it follows x1 is equal to 0. When x1 is equal to 0, x1 multiplied by 3 will be also 0. And this entry will be 0. And what is next entry? It is x2 multiplied by 1. And from here we cannot have anything, because beneath leading entry, this leading entry, beneath leading entry, we always have zeros. So the next entry here will be x2. So what do you think about x2? X2 must be 0. And similarly, x3 must be 0, because leading entries multiplied by x will also stick out in this eventual column. So the only way to make 0 out of these vectors is make all coefficients zeros. So these columns are these three columns, or these three, I better say, vectors. They're written as columns, but they're actually rows in our original matrix. These three vectors are linearly independent, and they span, of course, by performing this operation backwards, we will see that they span each of these four original vectors. So these vectors are a basis in our span, a basis in the span of these vectors, in this span is, I will take these vectors 1, 3, 2, negative 1, negative 2, 0, 0, 1, 2, 4. Okay. This non-zero row, non-zero row, and non-zero row. And the last one, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1. These three guys can serve as a basis in this spanning set, and this spanning set, because we have three vectors that form a basis, is three-dimensional. That's all we need to discover about it. And there is always structure, and see, in row echelon form, you always have leading entry and zeros beneath it. So when you form a linear combination, it will be this leading entry multiplied by this one, and it will come here. Nothing will prevent it from coming. So if you want it to be equal to zero vector, x1 must be zero. And similarly, it will happen to every other leading entry. That's why row space is so convenient for finding out a basis in a spanning set. This completes our topic about vectors in Rn. And it just generalizes our experiences with vectors in R2 and R3. And the next topic, the next thing we are going to do, we will bring geometry into space. And how do we bring geometry? What is geometry? We will bring lengths, and angles, right? And how do we do it? We will do it by means of a dot product, but this time it will be dot product in multi-dimensional spaces in Rn. So that's what we will start next time.